Heavenly Father, we are so grateful to come into your presence this morning. We bow before you. We acknowledge your greatness and your power and your holiness and righteousness. And like Richard taught us on Sunday, your sense of justice. And yet, we're so thankful that you are also a God of mercy. And that in your mercy, you sent your only Son, Jesus, to take our place, to save us from the sins that we have committed. We thank you that we can come into your presence now boldly as your children, not because of anything of worth in ourselves, but because of who he is and what he has done on our behalf. And so we bow before you this morning in adoration, in worship, with thankful hearts. We ask you to bless our study today, that as we examine your word and we look at the meaning of these chapters, that you will speak to our hearts. That as we share together the meaning, that we will truly be the body of Christ. We thank you for the many ways that you have worked through this class. We thank you for your presence with us each Thursday morning that we gather. I particularly thank you for each lady in this class, for each one's faithfulness, for their love, for their passion to know you more deeply. I pray, Lord, that you will give us eyes to have a vision of your kingdom, and how we, as little people here sitting in Greenville, South Carolina, have the great privilege to pray for fellow believers in Aleppo and Mosul and Egypt and China and Korea, Vietnam. We thank you, Lord, that you are a big God and yet you are a personal God. And so we do lift up the people that we know and love, the people in our circle of acquaintance, people in our Sunday school classes, people in our family, in our neighborhoods, who have needs, many of them for healing, but for other needs as well, Lord, for all kinds of brokenness in families or employment, for all kinds of needs that we may have. We thank you that you're a God whose desire is to bless us. But more than that, we pray that all of these people that we've listed this morning, that they would know you. And if they already do know you on some level, that through their difficulty, they will know you more deeply. We pray for your kingdom to come in their lives. We thank you, Lord, that you are a God who answers prayer. And so we lift ourselves up and ask, Lord, that you would use us in your kingdom work to be a people of blessing. Open our eyes and our hearts to hear the message that you would have of where you would send us. It might be right next door. It might be down the street. It might be in the next room. It might be to the lady at the beauty parlor. We thank you, Lord, that you have blessed us so richly. We ask for your continued blessing this morning, that we might be a people of blessing wherever we go. whatever we do. And so we pray these things in the name of Jesus, our Lord, our Savior, and our great high priest at your right hand, Father. Amen. Does anybody need a lesson? No, for today. I've got some for next time too, but I've got one for today.
Mary has fallen down on her job.
Well, I'll give you one for next time.
I think Tim needs a lesson too.
Well,
Walt had a computer fiasco.
Mm-hmm. Do you need a lesson for today? 7, 8, 9. A couple of weeks ago, Ann mentioned that she wanted the printout of the scripture, and I've been working on that, and I've got it almost done, so this week it should be going out. And I'm printing the New American Standard Bible, and I just want to ask you all, I don't know how many of you use that for marking up, and I know it's kind of late to give it to you now, but better late than never. In the New American Standard, there are alternate translations that are usually little footnotes at the bottom. Do you all want those as well?
Yes.
Well, no, they're not notes. It's not notes, but it's an alternate translation or more literal translation. I'll try to put those in if I can do that before I send it out. I've got the rest of it done, but I don't have that done, and I haven't really proofed it. So anyway, there's a lot of, when I transfer it over, there's a lot of formatting I have to do to get it in the format so that it's meaningful. Okay, so this is one of my favorite chapters in 1 and 2 Samuel, where David comes up with the idea that he wants to build a house for the Lord. And the Lord comes back to him and says no, as you all know. But it's not a rebuke. I guess the first question to ask you guys is, why did David decide that he wanted to build a house for the Lord?
He was concerned because it was in a tent, and he was living in a beautiful place, and he just felt like it needed to be in a beautiful place too.
Okay. So, what was his intent? I mean, there are a lot of reasons somebody might decide they would want to do something like that. Let's use this as an example of anything that we might want to do for the Lord. And I think it's a really good parallel for us, because there are a lot of times we think of something, we come up with some idea, oh, this would be wonderful to do for the Lord. But there are all kinds of reasons people want to do things for the Lord that are not noble. So we sort of have to look at the intent. I mean, a lot of people want to give, you know, they've lived a rotten life, and then they want to give a big gift to the church or to some organization so that people think well of them, right? I mean, there are all kinds of reasons, but we don't sense that here with David. We sense
people
that
to please the Lord.
He wanted to do something to honor the Lord. Did you all get that feeling?
Yeah.
Everybody in agreement with that? Okay.
He was sitting up in that fine house.
Yeah.
And he thought the Lord ought to have a place like that too.
And, you know, this goes back and to a heart of generosity, because of all that the Lord had done for him, what does he want to do? He wants to give to God something. And is that
the correct motivation for giving?
Yes.
Yes, it is. In fact, we need to work on that in our church. Did y'all know that? That's something we need to pray for people to be generous with the church. We're expanding our ministries, and people need to be generous, you know? And the reason for being generous is not because somebody says, well, now you ought to do this, that, and the other. The reason for giving should be that it's just an overflow of our hearts because of how the Lord has blessed us. How is the Lord, any of you who attend 11 o'clock, how is the Lord blessing you through our new music ministry?
Oh.
I mean, can y'all believe how great it is?
And I didn't think it was bad before he got here.
No. But it is fabulous. I mean, you know, it enhances our worship, doesn't it? I mean, it's not just a superfluous thing. It makes our worship deep and meaningful. It makes our concentration on the words of the hymns more, doesn't it? It's wonderful. And when we have experienced that gift to us, then what should our response be? Wow, we want to give back. Okay? So that's the motive. That's David's motivation. And like I said, there are a lot of other reasons that people give. They can feel guilty. They can want to impress other people. What else? Anything, any other motivations you can think of why people want to do something for the Lord?
Well, he tells us to tithe.
Well, he does. He does tell us that. But it should be out of a heart of generosity because of how we've been blessed. And so David tells this. He tells this to Nathan. And who was Nathan?
Prophet.
Now, we're going to watch Nathan, so I want you to know who he is, okay? Because he's important. He's a prophet. And so what does a prophet person do?
They're kind of a between God and the person.
Okay. And so we see him. He's a prophet. Remember, Samuel was a prophet to Saul, only Saul, they didn't have a functioning relationship for a long time during Saul's reign because of Saul's disobedience. But David and Nathan have a relationship. We're going to see how that's different from the relationship with Saul and Samuel. And so he mentions it to Nathan. And what does Nathan say?
He thinks it's a good idea.
Okay. So let's think about this. He comes up and sounds like great idea, you know.
Yes.
And so, but then he goes and he prays about it, or maybe he doesn't pray about it. Maybe he just, the Lord just spoke to him, you know, and let him know. So what did the Lord say to Nathan?
No.
He said no. And let's look at what God's word was, and so Nathan goes back to David, and of course this was probably hard because he knew that David really wanted to do this, and that he had good motives, and that it would have been a wonderful thing, because David lived in a nice cedar house. Cedar didn't grow around there. They had to get it from over in Lebanon or Tyre or Sidon or somewhere. And and the Lord's house was a tent. Now, we think, let's think about this tabernacle. It looked real shabby on the outside, remember? It just looked like skins and stuff on the outside, but what was it like on the inside?
It was different.
Ooh, wow. It was gorgeous. And everything in there symbolized the presence of the Lord. It was made, and if you remember, the children of Israel wandering around, you know, in the desert for all those years, and the tabernacle went around, and they all pitched their tents in a certain order around that tabernacle. If you were of a certain tribe, you knew that you were on the north side or the east side or whatever side of the tabernacle. You knew where your spot was in relation to that tabernacle. It was the center of everything. And when they got up and got ready to move, They all moved in a certain order. This one went first, that one the other. Certain way we've learned, the certain way to carry the different pieces of furniture, and they were all wrapped and covered so that the things that weren't supposed to be seen were all covered in a particular way, and they moved in a certain order, and certain of the priests, certain divisions of the priests carried certain items of furniture. It was very organized. It was not just, okay, it's time to move, and everybody just kind of heads out in a mass. It was very orderly. So, when the children of Israel made the tabernacle originally, I don't know if you remember this or not, but they made all the pieces. And, you know, it's very clear they went through and God said, I want you to do it this, 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 and this. And then it says that they made it this, 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 and this, which is the same as those thises, okay? And so when they finished everything, Moses examined it, and everything was done exactly like the Lord had said. Now, they messed up on everything else they ever did in the Old Testament. But this one thing they got right, and you can look at that. Let me see if I can find it kind of quick for you. I think maybe it's at the very end of Exodus.
You have a picture of it with it. I just think about that picture.
A picture's worth a thousand words, isn't it? Okay. A look at Exodus 40. So it says that thus Moses did according to all that the Lord had commanded him, so he did. So they not only made all the things, the items, exactly according to the pattern that God had given to Moses. It wasn't just, oh, I think I'm going to add this little decorative thing here or there. It was to be done in a certain way, which God prescribed. There was no creativity here in terms of what was supposed to be done. There was a pattern, and it was to be followed, and that's what they did. In verse 17, now it came about in the first month of the second year, on the first day of the month, that the tabernacle was erected. And then in verse 33, the end, it says, thus Moses finished the work of establishing everything. It says, then the cloud covered the tent of meeting, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. And Moses was not able to enter the tent of meeting because the cloud had settled on it, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. And so God gave his blessing by his presence there on the tabernacle, in the tabernacle. And it was not that God resided in the tabernacle. It was that the tabernacle was a place where God could meet with them. Do you sense the difference? God's much bigger than the tabernacle. He resides everywhere. He's everywhere. But this was a place where, because of man's sin, the sin could be atoned for, and it was a place where God and man could meet. Does that make sense to you? Very important. And so it says here, go back to 2 Samuel 7. the word of the Lord came to Nathan, and Nathan took this word to David, and he said, thus says the Lord. Now, you know, he's got to be really sure that that came from the Lord to say, thus says the Lord, right? Especially after he just told David, oh, sure, it'd be great to do that, you know? Are you the one who should build me a house to dwell in? For I have not dwelt in a house since the day I brought up the sons of Israel from Egypt, even to this day. But I have been moving about in a tent, even in a tabernacle. Now, we might look on a tent as being something derogatory, you know, of less value than a house. But think about it, he's been in their midst. He's been with the people wherever they've gone. He's given them a visual image that wherever they go, he is with them as they've moved around. Wherever I have gone with all the sons of Israel, did I speak a word with one of the tribes of Israel, which I commanded to shepherd my people of Israel, saying,
Why have you not built me a house of cedar? Now, therefore, thus you shall say to what? Now, who is David? Is he a servant?
He's a king, but a servant of God.
Okay, he's the king, but really and truly, who is the real king of Israel?
God.
So this is his servant, David. And so God is calling David his servant. And David later on calls God, that he affirms that he is a servant of God. So he understands his relationship, that though he is a king, he is a servant. And that's the attitude we should have too, is that we are blessed by God and he gives us dominion over certain areas in our lives, but at the same time we are servants. We are his servants. Thus says the Lord of hosts, I took you from the pasture, from following the sheep, that you should be ruler over my people Israel. So what's God saying to him?
Been with you.
The reason that you're king is because of me, of God. And I have been with you wherever you have gone and have cut off all your enemies from before you. Now, it took him a while, didn't it?
Yep.
To deal with Saul, you know. But through all of that, God has been with him. And does David know that?
Yes.
Yes, he does. And I will make you a great name, like the names of the great men who are on the earth. And I will also appoint a place for my people Israel, and I will plant them. That's the land. That they may live in their own place and not be disturbed again, nor will the wicked afflict them any more. Even from the day I commanded the judges to be over my people Israel, I will give you what? Rest from all your enemies. Now, does that happen? Well, for a while it does happen. Towards the end of David's reign, but in Solomon's reign it did. And then it says, the Lord, and I've underlined this in mind, the Lord also declares to you that the Lord will make a house for you. Now, the word house is used in two different senses here, isn't it? In the one sense, David wants to build a house, a building, you know, with walls and a roof and shingles and all that, a building for God. But on the other hand, God is wanting to build a house for David, and he's not talking about a building here. What is he talking about?
Okay.
A house, a family that will continue on after him. When your days are complete and you lie down with your fathers, I will raise up your descendant after you, who will come forth from you, and I will establish his kingdom. Now let's look at that verse. When your days are complete, in other words, when he gets ready to die, and you lie down with your fathers, what is that saying? What is that talking about?
Abraham and all the other great leaders that came before.
Yeah. But they're going to be together in the afterlife. They're going to be with one another. The implication is that there's going to be fellowship with one another in the afterlife after he dies. And I will raise up your descendant. Now, who is he talking about there?
His descendants.
Well, it's singular.
Son?
Well, he's talking about a son, but he's also talking about Jesus, who is his marvelous descendant, okay? And I will establish his kingdom. And he shall build a house for my name. Now think about that. Solomon is going to build a house, a building, but Jesus is going to build a lineage, a line, right? It's the same distinction. So God's going to do both things. And I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. And this is important.
the forever, because the dynasty of David will last forever. Now think about how that comes to be, that Jesus in the New Testament, in all of the Gospels, he is referred to as what? A son of David, from the lineage of David. They trace his lineage back on Mary's side and Joseph's side, because one of the lineages is through Joseph, even though Joseph is his adoptive father, and through his mother. Both of them go back. They go different ways, but they go back through David. And that's important, isn't it? Because Jesus is in the line of David, and because he is our Savior, our King, our Lord, and his kingdom lasts forever, that is a fulfillment of this prophecy that the Lord is giving to David. And I'm sure David did not understand all the dimensions of this, but he knew that God was going to bless him with a line, a lineage after him, that he wasn't going to be like Saul and be cut off. His line was going to continue. Now, he had some pretty disreputable people that were in his line through the ages after him. But God always, and at one point, it got down to one person who was hidden, what was not killed. All the other children of that thing were killed, except for the one who was hidden. So that, you know, the devil was really trying to get at that lineage, but he was not successful. Okay. And I will be a father to him, and he will be a son to me. When he commits, now notice this, when he commits iniquity, I will correct him with the rod of men and the strokes of the sons of men. So God is committing here to be a father, not only to have a lineage, but to have a lineage forever. Look at all these promises. And he promises to be a father. And what does a father do for a son?
Cares for him, teaches him.
And he disciplines him, doesn't he?
Discipline. Mm-hmm. Well, that's careful.
And so, you know, in Hebrews, I think I had you all look this up. Well, in Hebrews, it talks about... well, let's just look at it, because it's important. Look over to Hebrews 12. It's talking about, in Hebrews here, it's talking about the discipline of the Lord. And he's talking about the suffering that they are enduring. He's saying, verse 3, Hebrews 12, 3, "For consider him who has endured such hostility by sinners against himself, so that you may not grow weary and lose heart. You have not yet resisted to the point of shedding blood in your striving against sin. And you have forgotten the exhortation which is addressed to you as sons. My son, do not regard lightly the discipline of the Lord, nor faint when you are reproved by him. For those whom the Lord loves, he disciplines, and he scourges every son whom he receives." Now that is a quote from the Old Testament. Where is it a quote from? Where is that? Yeah. Okay. Then verse 7. "It is for discipline that you endure. God deals with you as with sons. For what son is there whom his father does not discipline? But if you are without discipline, of which all have become partakers, then you are illegitimate children and not sons. Furthermore, we had earthly fathers to discipline us, and we respected them. Shall we not much rather be subject to the Father of spirits and live? For they disciplined us for a short time as seemed best to them, but he disciplines us for our good," what? "That we may share his holiness. All discipline for the moment seems not to be joyful, but sorrowful. Yet to those who have been trained by it," you know, it's like
Have you ever had a plant or a tree that you're trying to train? And you're trying to train that thing to go up straight, and sometimes you clamp it to a stick or something and you make it go straight, even though the plant may not like that. You know, I haven't asked too many plants lately, but maybe it's faithful. But that's the image here, that we are, that the sufferings that we endure train us as God would have us to be trained, so that we may become like Him. Afterwards, it yields the peaceful fruit of righteousness. He's training us for righteousness. So if I want my tree to go straight up, you know, I think of a crepe myrtle or something, and you have this limb and it's, you know, it's going out this way and you don't want it to go that way, you want it to be more straight, you tie it up to the rod that's going straight the way you want it to go, so that it will learn to go that way. And that's training. That's how we train plants. I wish Phoebe Blackson was here to talk about training. She knows so much about plants. God doesn't promise us that if we become, and that's where I differ with this prosperity gospel. You know, if you become a Christian, then everything's going to be wonderful in your life, and you're going to be rich, and everything's, you know, you're not going to have any troubles or anything. That's not true. If that were true, then people would become Christians so they wouldn't have to go through anything. But God uses the troubles of this world in order to work His work in us. And He has far more blessing than we can ever imagine, far beyond what we would ever think of. So, but it is a dynasty that is being established here forever. But it's a dynasty under discipline. It's not going to be easy. It's not going to be without trouble. And a lot of these kings that come forth, his great-grandchildren and so forth, have lots of problems, and the Lord disciplines them strongly for what they've done. And eventually, the children of Israel have to do what? They have to go into captivity for 70 years in Babylon. God is still with them, though, right? Okay. Now, so then how does David respond to this? Does he
accepts it.
Yeah. And God's not, he's not rebuking David for having the thought of building the house. He's not saying no in anger in any way towards David. He was very loving and giving towards David. But he's letting David know that his plans are much bigger than just a house, a building. So David responds, and he just sits in awe of the Lord. You know, and he talks to the Lord here. And he talks about God's greatness. And I told you before that up there in verse 8, God refers to David as his servant. And down here in this part, David refers to himself as God's servant. So David understands. David is amazed. Look at verse 21. For the sake of thy word and according to thine own heart, thou hast done all this greatness to let thy servant know. I mean, God could have done this without letting David know that he was going to do this, right? He could have let David have. But it shows God's commitment to the covenant. It shows something that David has to believe in faith. Can he know this for certain? What does he have to do? He has to believe what God has said. And so then, in this part, he also connects this covenant that God is making with David to the covenant that was made at Sinai with the children of it, with all the children of Israel. And he says, verse 23, and what nation on the earth is like thy people Israel, whom God went to redeem for himself as a people and to make a name for himself and to do a great thing for thee and awesome things for thy land, before thy people whom thou hast redeemed for thyself from Egypt, from nations and their gods. For thou hast established for thyself thy people Israel. Remember, he did that
at Sinai as an own people forever. And now he's establishing David's line as the kingly line forever as well. So he's connecting those two covenants. The Davidic covenant and the Sinai covenant are come together here for the blessing of his people Israel. Verse 27, "For thou, O Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, hast made a revelation to thy servant." So how did David know this? God revealed it to him. And so how do you respond when God reveals something to you? Have you been reading your Bible and all of a sudden you have this aha moment sometimes? And you just get this kind of, you see something? And you know it applies to you, and you know the truth of it, and you've never seen it before. It'd been there all that time. You know, those words weren't added while you were sleeping last night. And it's because God reveals it. And so anyway, I think that's... "Now therefore, may it please thee to bless the house of thy servant, that it may continue forever before thee. For thou, O Lord God, hast spoken, and with thy blessing may the house of thy servant be blessed forever." So he is accepting the blessing which God is giving him. He's rejoicing over it. You know, Saul had wanted a dynasty so much. You remember that? He wanted Jonathan. He couldn't understand why Jonathan didn't have more ambition. Right?
And Jonathan just like David.
Well, Jonathan knew. Jonathan had his place, and God had blessed him, but God had planned for David. But let me read you this quote. I found this real amazing. Saul, by clinging tenaciously to what he regarded as his kingly prerogative, lost the kingdom. David, more concerned about honoring the Lord than guarding his own reputation, had his kingdom made sure forever. Remember, he danced before the people. Remember, his wife didn't like it. And he danced before the Lord just in sheer abandonment of himself. He was more interested in honoring the Lord than he was in what people thought about him. That's not saying we should all go out and get naked to praise the Lord. But what it is saying is that we should be more concerned. You know, if your hair doesn't look so hot that day, Becky, it would have been okay to come to Bible study last week with your face all messed up, or week before last. More concerned about honoring the Lord than about how we look or what impression we're making on other people, but with abandonment, just loving the Lord. We as Presbyterians are not real good at, you know, we're kind of the frozen chosen. And so we're not real good at abandonment before the Lord. But we should be. We should be. Now, the next chapter, chapter 8, is really... more about David's military successes, and it sort of goes over these rather quickly. The deal is that all of these countries are in on every direction. His military successes are just all around him. First of all, with the Philistines, and remember, they live on the... Philistines lived over here. And let's look at the other ones. Moab is east of Israel. I'm not sure if these are on here or not. These are there's Edom down here. Here's Moab.
So the Philistines would be to the west, and Moab is to the east. That Zobah is a mountainous kingdom to the north of Damascus. So it's way up north. To restore his rule at the river would be a reference there to the Euphrates. So the kingdom went all the way, really, from the Euphrates River all the way down south. The Arameans were north of Israel. That's in verse 6, verse 5 and 6. The buck stops with David. He's going to make sure. And I don't know if he heard all the cases himself or if he... but he took special authority to make sure that it was done right for his people, the handling of matters of justice. And I wondered at first why he took on that responsibility for himself. Why do you think?
Because he was the ruler over Israel. He wanted to make it fair to everybody.
Okay. Well, and think about the times that he lived in. How cruel and bloodthirsty were some of these people around him. So he was making sure that those were not the kind of people who were making the decisions over his people, over God's people. And David took that responsibility seriously. I see that in verse 15. I think I asked you that question in question number 6. The other thing is that, if you remember, and I think I pointed this out to you before, in Deuteronomy 17, there were instructions for the king. Remember, he was not supposed to multiply wives. Well, he was not supposed to multiply what else?
Horses.
Horses. And why do we say that?
Fighting.
I know you use horses for other things, but if you had a horse and your enemy did not have horses and you had horses, you had a military advantage. It would be like having nuclear weapons and the other people didn't have nuclear weapons. So that was a great military advantage. And so Israel was not to rely on their military strength. They were to rely upon the Lord. Okay. And so they were not to multiply wives. The king was not to multiply wives. The king was not to multiply horses. What else was the king supposed to do? Do you remember that from Deuteronomy? Look back at Deuteronomy 17. He shall not greatly increase silver and gold for himself. Verse 17. Deuteronomy 17, 17. So is David doing that one right? Yes, he's dedicated. And then when he comes to the throne, in verse 18, when he sits on the throne of his kingdom, he shall write for himself a copy of the law on a scroll,
yes,
in the presence of the Levitical priests. So it's like he's going to school. And so he's going to write out a copy of the law. Well, are you going to learn it pretty well if you write it down?
Yes.
I mean, he's got to write from Genesis all the way through Leviticus.
He has to read it every day, so I know he remembers it.
So you remember when you write it, you remember it a lot better than if you just read it over. And then he had to keep it, and he had to read it every day. So he had to copy it in the presence of the Levitical priests, so they could explain it to him as he was going. If there were any questions, they were there because they were supposed to know the law, right? And so he was supposed to learn of them about the law, and he was to keep a copy, and he was to read it periodically because he had this copy of it. So David is the logical one to administer justice, probably along with the Levitical priests, because why?
He knows the law.
He knows the law, and he's immersed in the law, supposedly. So to me, that was a very good reason why David, and keep in mind, people didn't have books. I mean, you know, we take for granted having books. I mean, you look at even a couple hundred years ago, you know, people had, you know, they had secretary desks. At the top of the secretaries, they kept their books, their few books they had. I mean, I dare say, I mean, my house is just overrun with books. I mean, I run out of places to put them. I don't know if y'all are like I am or not, yes. But I mean, I just run out of places. And we're so blessed with books. But, you know, the average person didn't have a scroll back then of the law. They were dependent on somebody else to tell them about it. And so David knew the law, so he wasn't going to leave it up to somebody else who, a lot of those people were bloodthirsty and basing everything on vengeance. And so David made sure that he took over that function himself. Let's see. Also, I mentioned to you about verse 4. And chapter 8, verse 4, David captured 1,700 horsemen and 20,000 foot soldiers, and David hamstrung the chariot horses, but reserved enough of them for 100 chariots. So he, and I don't know if you all looked up some of those things about the horses. We have talked about that before, but it says that in Deuteronomy, it says the king should not multiply horses. Psalm 20, this is question 4. Psalm 20, some boast in chariots and some in horses, but we will boast in the name of the Lord, our God. So what would a translation of that today be, maybe? We might boast about our tanks or our missiles or our guns or whatever. Would be the same thing. But no, we will boast in the Lord. He will take care of us.
Nancy, do you know what hamstringing horses
is? Tell me what that is.
They injure the abdomen.
Yeah.
Oh, I was going to say,
on the back leg.
Yeah, the back, your hamstring is back here.
They cut them.
Uh-huh.
And they can't walk.
Well, they
can can't walk at all?
They can't pull a chariot, yeah. But they can still be used for other things. And they can walk a little bit. Because I looked at it.
Yeah.
They can be used
depends on how badly they just say.
But they can't pull a chariot and run fast.
They can't run
fast.
But yeah. They could probably pull a plow or something like that.
That was what, when I looked at that was what I thought. They can't go in battle and run fast and pull a chariot, but they can still be used for maybe domestic or something. Not
like pulling around in a circle, grinding corn.
The water, maybe they walk around a circle and pump the water up from the well.
Yeah, or grind them.
Or grind something.
Yeah.
It's
cruel.
Well, but that was making it so that they were not useful for war. So okay, so and then he talks about, let me finish that.